Welcome back to Channel 2. I hope you had a great lunch. We're excited to have Brian Rau, our 2019 Aviation Hall of Fame inductee, joining us for the next session. Brian is here to talk about the Recreational Aviation Foundation. Brian, take it away.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the North Dakota Aviation Association virtual conference. This is the Recreational Aviation Foundation presentation, and I'm going to start right in with a video and then we'll go into some introductions.
Thanks for
another 50
have airport
site. We got both the MD-80 and the field
inside 84 and 80. IQA Alpha is going to be closed. That is 360 heavy. Runway 25 right, line up and wait. Traffic's crossed downfield. Scout is 635 as you're able. Make the right turn at Foxtrot. Hold short, runway 25 right.
250 to intercept. Cross Bonzo at 4000. Cleared ILS, runway 27 right approach.
I did.
Sorry,
Bonzo.
Runway
17
has an equal inbreak gate on the opposite side of the runway.
Perhaps it is the color of the sun caught flat and covered. The crossroads I'm standing on. Or maybe it's the weather or something like that. I mean no trouble, please don't put me down, don't get upset. Oh, sin, I can't forget you. I do not pace the floor, bow down and bend, but yet, oh, mommy, you've been on my mind.
Okay, well, again, my name is Brian Rau. I'm the North Dakota liaison to the Recreational Aviation Foundation. And Rick, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself?
Okay, and this is Rick McPhail. I'm also with the Recreational Aviation Foundation as an ambassador. And the picture you're looking at here is one of my airplanes that I do a little ice fishing with.
Okay, and I think we all got into recreational aviation a slightly different way. My picture here was down in Utah. I started doing backcountry stuff probably in the early 2000s. Before I had heard about the Recreational Aviation Foundation, I had heard about an organization called the Utah Backcountry Pilots Association and started going down there and hanging around with some of those guys and then found out about the Recreational Aviation Foundation. We have Jeff Vaught is also an RAF ambassador, and he's not able to be on today. When he is on, some of you have been here before to our presentations, and he's also with the Seaplane Pilots Association, and Jeff wasn't able to make it today. I'd like to talk a little bit about the RAF. The RAF is basically about airstrips, and it's kind of a personal thing, but what you describe as recreational airstrip, I use the definition that it's one where once you land there, there's something recreational in nature you can do with, without much further travel. So that tends to then be backcountry type airstrips to get in close to where you want to be, but not always. We have municipal strips that are perfect recreational airstrips. And so the RAF works on preserving these, improving these airstrips, and creating new airstrips. And Rick and I are going to be putting this presentation on together. And Rick, if you ever have anything you need to add, just go ahead and add it in there.
Absolutely.
And so how do we accomplish that? Basically by stewardship efforts. We want to provide aviators with a destination to fly to and a passion for that. And Rick, a little bit later, Rick's going to talk a little bit more about memories and building relationships and things like that. The RAF started in 2003, right next door to us in Montana. It had 6 members. They were enthusiastic, but they really didn't know where this was going to go. If you've ever been involved in starting something new, you know, you try to plan, but you're never really sure which way things are going to go. Are they going to thrive? Is it going to bust? What's going to happen? So they had no clear path. They just knew they had to do something to protect these airstrips. Montana's got a lot of recreational backcountry type airstrips, and some of them were being closed and stuff. So these 6 guys got together and said, we've got to do something about this. So in 2021, the RAF is 18 years old, and we're active in 50 states. We've got 9,000 plus members. We're a 501c3, which is important when we talk about some of the airstrips and how the RAF has acquired some of these airstrips. And we believe we have a clear vision for the future. One thing about the RAF that's a little bit different than a typical organization is we start with the members. A lot of times members are down at the bottom of an organization, but we'd like to start with the members, the liaisons, and the ambassadors. You know, the only paid personnel the RAF has is this volunteer coordinator. And she's not, it kind of sounds a little funny to call a paid position volunteer, but she's the coordinator who coordinates all of us volunteers. And she's got a full-time job. But everybody else, administration, go ahead, Rick.
Oh, I was just going to say, she sure does.
And so officers and board directors, everybody else is volunteer in this organization. So this is our membership, just kind of a graphic depiction of where our members are. We've got them up in Alaska, down in Hawaii, all through the United States and into Canada. Just a breakdown a little bit into focus in on North Dakota a little bit. We've got 56 members in North Dakota, and we're always looking for more. There's a lot of things we can do, and we're talking a little bit about the RAF now, but we're going to quickly move into North Dakota issues, and Rick is going to talk about some Minnesota things going on. Now, I would like to say I'm trying kind of watching the chats too. So if anybody has any questions or comments, just let me know and we can address those right away. It's a little bit different for us doing this virtual conference. I've done some for other organizations and it goes okay, but I can't wait till we can all get together again. So like I mentioned before, the RAF is all about airstrips. The list is so long, we can't go over all the airstrips that the RAF has been a part of being involved in opening them up and maintaining them. So I'm just going to give a few examples of some. Probably what's sometimes considered our biggest win is Ryan Field in Montana. This is right near Glacier National Park. The airstrip, you can see my pointer is right here, obviously in wintertime here. Just this last year, they got done, they call it a barn raising, but they built this new facility for a pilot's area. There's camping there. It's like I said, hiking. It's right next to Glacier National Park. And this field is interesting in that the people who own this property donated it to the RAF and took advantage of that 501c3 tax status that we have. As I mentioned before, so a lot of times they're backcountry airstrips, but not all the time. Goodspeed, Connecticut was an airstrip, it's a paved airstrip that was going to be closed, but it's a seaplane base also. And the RAF got involved and has managed to keep it open. There's a lot of recreational activities right near the airstrip. So there's sometimes a recreational airstrip can be a paved paved airstrip. There's nothing says you have to have the great big tires on to take advantage of recreational airstrips. Grapevine, Arizona is another one of those same thing. This was an airstrip that basically was just used for the military and then was going to be closed. It's out in the someplace out in the desert there. And the Arizona Pilots Association, along with the RAF, got involved and spruced it up, put some camping areas in, some places to dine. And they go out there during the appropriate parts of the year for Arizona, appropriate times of the year. They go out there every weekend and have a fly in there. And again, just to give some examples, Two Hearted, Michigan, it was an airstrip previously. It was a CCC, a Civilian Conservation Corps airstrip. You can kind of see the airstrip here, right up in here. But the Michigan liaison and some ambassadors there got together and they got approval to get it spruced up and opened up. And this is kind of a view of it over here from the ground now. Trigger Gap, Arkansas. This is in the Ozarks down in Arkansas. This is getting to be a very popular place, not just this airstrip, but many others in that, you know, the Ozark Mountain type area of Arkansas. This particular airstrip was actually didn't exist before the RAF got involved and built this airstrip. And that takes a lot of doing to get together and put an airstrip together from scratch. So most of the time we're about airstrips, but not all of the time. In this, the airstrip was just fine, a paved airstrip, but there was no really good place for pilots to be able to do anything really. So this facility was built to serve as a pilot's lounge and restrooms, showers, all those type of things here. North Fox Island is in Lake Michigan. It's an interesting airstrip. It did exist prior to the Michigan people getting to work on it. They were able to actually lease this from the government agency that controls that. And the only way you can access it is by the airport or by boat, this island. And as you can see from the dense foliage, a lot of hunting opportunities and hiking and just general enjoying the outdoors there. And as I mentioned before, we go all up the way to Alaska. This airstrip was being encroached on both ends by trees, making it less useful. And these guys got together and got it opened up. Again, built a pilot shelter there and got things going. Advocacy. So this is one thing that the RAF works on. And what is advocacy? There's several different definitions, but basically the definition I like is influence public policy by using facts and relationships. The RAF is big on both of those things. Facts are very important when you're talking to government agencies about public policy. But it's surprisingly, you know, these government people are all people too, and building relationships with them. And Rick is going to talk in a couple minutes more about relationships in this aviation business that we're all in, or not business necessarily, but activity. So doing this advocacy, state liaisons do a lot of work. And I would add to this, the ambassadors, and just people without any title who help out. And, you know, down at the bottom left side, it says working with local pilot communities. In North Dakota, we've got one particular airstrip and probably some others that we're looking at. And what we're really going to need to do is meet with the North Dakota Aviation Association when we get ready to put do public comments and to do works air parties and things like that. Because one liaison and two ambassadors can't get as much done as we can with the whole state involved. We work with Congress. John McKenna, he was one of the original six people. He had been the president of the foundation for a long time. He's now the chairman. He does a lot of work both locally and in Washington, D.C. There's several people in the RAF that go to Washington, pre-pandemic anyway, went to Washington a lot. And it's just, again, building relationships and presenting facts. And again, along this relationship, you've got to work with these public land managers. They've got a job to do too, and they've got certain priorities that they've been told they're supposed to follow. And so we like to work with them. I like to bring this airstrip in Death Valley National Park to light for a couple of reasons. Sometimes you'll hear people say that you can't have backcountry airstrips in a national park. Well, that just isn't true. Death Valley's got a couple of them. And this may come to light out in Medora, where the old Buddy Ranch airstrip sits partially on Forest Service land, partially on National Park Service land. I always like to talk about Chicken Strip also because it's kind of a fun story. This is near some sort of hot springs in Death Valley. And evidently the strip they were using was right up closer to the airstrips, like, you know, maybe a half mile to a mile closer to the hot springs, excuse me. But it was evidently a pretty dicey airstrip to land on. So pilots who didn't want to land there would go over and land on a section of the dirt road. Well, eventually, and so if you didn't want to land on the dicey airstrip, you were chicken, so you went over to land on the chicken strip. And eventually, the other airstrip was closed altogether, and they just used a section of road, which is actually quite common in backcountry. In Utah, same thing. You'll have a section of road that gets widened out a little bit, and you use that for an airstrip. The other thing the RAF has is regional conferences. Now, neither myself or Rick or Jeff were able to get to any of these. Jeff and I had planned on going to the one in Wisconsin in 2020, but of course that got canceled. And so these are just a way to network and to learn about what other people are doing to have successes on opening airstrips and such. You know, in partnerships, we like to partner with all kinds of different groups. You've probably seen some of the RAF partnerships with the AOPA, for example. A few years ago, they did, I think it was John McKenna's Cub that they fixed up and gave away for the sweepstakes that they do every year. But in addition to those type of partnerships, we have to work with the public land managers and private partners also. The Forest Service is going to come into play, in particular with one of the airstrips that we're going to talk about. And in many areas, BLM is a huge partner. We work with private groups too, like the Nature Conservancy. Kind of interesting. So the Elkhorn Ranch Lands airstrip north of Medora that we're trying to open, I attended a meeting, and there was a group, I forget, it was North Dakota History Group. And they were kind of like, oh, we don't really want to support, an airstrip out in this pristine area in the Badlands, until I started talking to them about the history of the airstrip and how it got used for, how the cowboys, basically the ranchers, when somebody went to town, they'd line up the time for the Dickinson guys to fly out to that airstrip and pick them up. They'd meet them out there and they'd fly them someplace. There was a lot of history involved. And then this lady, she started shaking her head. Yeah, I can see that. So you got to work with these people and try to make partnerships with people. Now, memorandums of understanding, a couple of things here that are important. We've got one with the Forest Service and with the BLM. And they basically say that, you know, we agree, the RAF will do certain things and the Forest Service will do certain things. And we basically agree that if we both do those things, it can be mutually beneficial and to both them and to the flying public. And as a result of these memorandums, U.S. Forest Service issued this memo. It first talked about the, you know, aviation as part of the country's heritage. And then it talked about how it can enhance access for legitimate recreational activities. And this is going to be very important for North Dakota as we try to open up some of these airstrips on Forest Service land. So let's talk a little bit about North Dakota and the surrounding areas. Just which way is the wind blowing in North Dakota? I'm going to talk again about the Elkhorn Ranch lands. I think I'm almost willing to bet that some of you here have heard me talk about this probably over and over again too many times. But just for those of you who haven't, there is an airstrip on some land that the Forest Service acquired back in 2007. And it used to be called the Ebert's Ranch. They've started to call it the Elkhorn Ranch. So we've started to call it the Elkhorn Ranchlands Airstrip. Now, I look back my records. I've been talking to the Forest Service since 2011 about this airstrip, so 10 years. And right away, there seemed to be a path forward. The path forward was they were going to open up this land use management plan. And then we'd get to make our case for opening this airstrip and getting it fixed up and getting it working and such. But things always got pushed back. It was always going to be next year or 2 years from now. When I talked to this group last year, they told us in 2021, they were going to start this plan to be opened up for comments. Well, I talked to there's always a new district ranger there. And she tells me it's not going to start now till 2023. And I talked to her about how long we've been doing this and that it really isn't working out, it isn't acceptable. And she seemed open to a different path forward. And that was to try to get this done with a special use permit or special use authorization. And we've just started to talk to her about it. This lady seems very nice and informative, but she had no idea about our desire to open up this airstrip. So back to the advocacy, we're now trying to develop relationships and we are trying to present facts to her. This is the third, since I've been dealing with this is the third district ranger we've had to kind of educate and bring up to speed on the RAF and what we want to do up here in the Elkhorn Ranchlands area. And just a little bit about why we think this airstrip is worth the effort. About midsummer last year, I did a little flight over there. You can see the airstrip right up here. It runs approximately northwest, south, east. So we're looking about straight west. And let's play this here. So I'm just going to make a low approach in here and we're making a kind of a right-hand traffic because left-hand traffic, you're over a little bit of higher terrain up in here. So I made a right-hand traffic here. And you can actually make, again, you see this airstrip right up here. You can actually make a fairly normal approach, a normal approach angle here, although you're lower to the terrain than you would normally be on most North Dakota airstrips, especially right when in here. But I'm doing what I consider a fairly normal angle of an approach here. I'm not going to land. I'm just going to stay about 100 feet up in the air. You can see So there's some trees right here. It'd be nice to get them cut back. But beyond that, once you get down here, it's a fairly flat airstrip, slopes ever so slightly to the northwest. We're facing northwest now. There's a few little things that need to be done with the airstrip. We're coming up on where our road crosses the end of the airstrip. That would need a little work. And so you could use the extra 300 feet there. But, you know, and going this way, it's almost a full mile till you get to this higher elevation. We're flying right now over. It's Red Tail. Red Creek that we're going over. And you can follow this. You can make a slight left turn and follow this drainage and keep going downhill all the way to the Little Missouri, which is about another 3 miles away. Going the other way, you could also take a little bit of a, we'll go back up here a second. If you were coming up the other way, you could just take a left and follow the drainage, although you would be going uphill. It'd still be pretty manageable. So from that standpoint, we think this is an ideal backcountry airstrip. This part of the airstrip was taken very early last year in the spring. Things had just started to green up. I'm standing right where that road crossed the airstrip. And then the next slide is standing in the same place looking the other way. This is that higher terrain here that we flew over on the way in. And the airstrip, if you can see it here in this picture, has got a little bit of a crown to it. You can see there's a little bit of a ditch there. And you know, that's good. This was a prepared airstrip. This was not just something that somebody started driving up and down and decided to fly an airplane off of it. And that's good in that this airstrip seems to have fairly good drainage. When you look around, let me go back one slide. This area here is pretty low, and there's been cattle in here, and you can see the divots where the hoof prints where the cattle have been walking around with sweat. You don't really see that up on the airstrip, even though there's been cattle there. So I think it's a fairly well drained and would make for a good airstrip. The other there are a few of these divots in here, you know, a dozen to two dozen of these in the airstrip. They don't look to be like active rodent holes of any kind. You can see there's been cows out here, but they don't really look like the things cows have been making either. So, you know, there's going to be some things like that to fill in. But the other reason is this thing has facilities, basically. There's still power there because they have a well for the cattle. And there's trees there. I mean, you could have ideal camping sites there. There's my wife, Ellie, and I, we went hiking around up in these hills one time when we were there. And it just has endless possibilities for recreation, like camping, hiking, biking, and those type of things. So that's why we keep putting this effort into the Elkhorn Ranch lands. And we're going to be moving forward. We're going to try to move forward with the special use land authorization. And at some point I'm going to be contacting all of you guys saying, hey, we need your help. And hopefully sooner rather than later. But Jeff and Rick and I are going to be meeting with this new ranger here sometime within a month here now. A little bit of other things then. We've talked about Riverdale and for quite a few years also, and in good locations for recreational flying. I know on Riverdale in 2019, I think it was the Pilots Association had a little fly in there. I wasn't able to attend that, but I saw it sounds like it went well. We could look at something like that again. Oops, didn't mean to go ahead for it yet. You know, there's one thing that people overlook, right off the end of this airstrip, there's a camping area. Used to be a camping area. It's just kind of a recreation area now. Most of the other activities over on the other end of the strip, but this is very close to the airstrip, and most of it it used to be a swimming area. Most of it washed away in the flood of, when was that? I can't remember what day that was again, but when they had to open the gates up. And so I think that's something we need to look at, see if we could use for the Recreational Aviation Foundation, or the Pilots Association, which now is the Aviation Association in North Dakota. One thing that's new that we've added for our list, the Park River. The Park River airstrip is airport. Here's the Park River Airport. But what makes this one nice for recreational purposes is there is a nice recreational area here on Home Reservoir. The you know, there's a nice swimming area here. There's camping back in here. There's a playground for the kids. And it's about 3/4 mile either hike or walk or bike ride. And there's I don't know if you can see it here, but there's a bike path, a hike and a walking path right along here. Very convenient. Right off the end of the airport, you can just go over here and go there. And of course, this is different for everybody. Ellie and I walked this last summer. It's no problem. We also have these bikes we like to fold up and carry along and ride. But we think that's a good recreational destination in North Dakota. This is just the entrance to that recreation area. And this is just a flyover picture of it. Indicate here's the swimming area. There were some, it was kind of cool that day we were there, but there were some kids swimming out there. Okay, at this time, I'd asked Rick if he could talk about some things in Minnesota. There's a couple of really neat recreational strips in Minnesota. So yep. Rick, you want to take over there?
Sure, you betcha. You know, hi guys. You can hear me okay?
We got you.
Okay. I'm kind of using my phone as well as the computer. So, but hey fellas, thanks for having us. We really appreciate it. You know, we've done this a couple of different times and we've gotten some good feedback from everybody, but the Recreational Aviation Foundation is dear to my heart in many ways. And it all kind of starts with getting together with, you know, like-minded people. And I'll tell you a quick story. I was actually out in Montana, Lincoln, Montana, many, many years ago. I flew a 180 I had out there and met a friend of mine and we went fishing, but I landed in Lincoln and Lincoln has no services. It's just a little hard surface strip. And a guy came up to me, an older gentleman by the name of Jerry Kane. And he said, well, if you need a place to put your airplane, you can put it in this hangar over here. So I did that. And he asked me what I was up to. And I told him I was going to go fishing for a couple of days. He said, well, when you get back, let me know. And he said, I'll come out and make sure, you know, your airplane's ready to go and we'll get you out of here. Well, I did that. And I actually the weather got me socked in and he invited me out to his ranch. And we started visiting. We had dinner and he talked to me about the Recreational Aviation Foundation. And at that time, he was one of the six guys that started it. And so it was just by happenstance that I met this guy. And 2 years ago, we flew the 185, the one you see in the picture there. We flew that out to Bozeman, my wife and I and son. And unbeknownst to us, I got an email and they were having a barbecue up at Jerry's place to honor him as an emeritus director. And a bunch of the Montana RAF folks were going up there. And I wasn't an ambassador or anything like that. I sent in $50 one year or whatever. It doesn't matter what you send in, whether it's 10 or 50 or 500. I just wanted to support the group because I really liked what they stood for. And, you know, I'd get a letter every year and a newsletter but anyway, I got this email that said they were having this barbecue up at Lincoln. And that's northwest of Bozeman. So we were out there for the weekend and I told my wife, I said, hey, let's on Saturday, let's fly up to Lincoln. And I said, I'll bet you we'll be the farthest ones, you know, farthest away, you know? So we went up there and we just had a ball. And that's where I met John McKenna. And I fly in and I'm in my 185 and there's a whole ramp full of airplanes. you know, and I thought I was going to be the farthest one. Hell, people came from all over to see Jerry, and I had no idea, you know, who this guy was and what he had done for this organization. But I learned that day. Well, John was there in his camp mobile. He didn't fly in. He drove in and he camped overnight at the airport. And I got to know John. And so John said, well, you need to, you know, get involved in this group. And so push came to shove. I became an ambassador for North Dakota and Minnesota, and haven't looked back, actually. It's been a lot of fun. And the reason it's so fun is because of all the people you meet. The picture you see here on the left-hand side is an old, I think it's a 64 mall. I'm not sure, but that's Dave. And that's my son, Hayden. Now, Hayden is, you know, quite a bit bigger than that. He's 12 years old now and 175 pounds. So, and this is Dave. And we see Dave at a lot of the different fly-ins that we go to, but you make a lot of friends. And on the picture on the right is Hayden and I camping. And this is actually in an airstrip. And you see my orange shirt there sitting on the chair. We went camping, and this is in Bowstring, Minnesota. And Bowstring is an airport that was going to close a couple of years ago. And we got involved. There it is there. There's Bowstring. We got involved in the Bowstring Regional Airport Association. And Kurt Panuto, the liaison of Minnesota, Jeff Russell from Wisconsin came in. And again, I didn't know these guys. I just showed up. This was before I met John McKenna and before I was involved with the RAF. I just showed up to a meeting at the Bowstring Airport where the county had a couple attorneys and they were basically getting ready to shut the airport down. The RAF showed up with Kurt and Jeff Russell. I listened to what they had to say. And, you know, before you knew it, the RAF was involved. We put together some camping spots out there. We gave them a grant, and now the airport's flourishing. And it's just a beautiful area. It's in between Bemidji, Minnesota, and Grand Rapids, Minnesota. And just a wonderful, wonderful place. And every year they have a fly-in in September, and then another one in the spring. And it's just a great group of guys. And the RAF has been a big part of that, keeping that airport open. Another airport in Minnesota, which just recently we got involved with, is Isle Airport. And this is down near Mille Lacs Lake. And you can see the lake in the background. And this is actually a private airport. Well, I shouldn't say it's private. The city owns it, but they wanted to close it, but it's run by a group of guys who have hangars out there. And the city wanted to close it because you see the trees on the far end here. The FAA basically said, you got to cut those down. And the city said, well, we don't have the money. And so these guys who have these hangars there said, now what do we do? You know, we don't have, you know, we don't want to pitch in all this money, you know, and the city still owns the airport. So the RAF got involved, and a $14,000 grant later from the RAF, and now with a memorandum of understanding that the RAF has access to this airport for camping, we came in and we gave them the money to cut down the trees to meet the FAA requirement. And it relinquished the city from that expense, and it kept the airport open. And now the RAF has a really unique little campsite and airport that they can go to. So, you know, what's really cool about this organization, you guys, is that, you know, with a little bit of effort and a lot of friends, you can do a lot. And it's just been a riot getting to know some of these people. I'm getting ready to retire, and my wife says, well, what are you going to do? Because she's 10 years younger than me, and she thinks I should work. And I said, while you're working, honey, for the next 5 or 10 years, I'm going to go out and I'm going to go to some of these work parties and these other areas out in Montana, Idaho, you know, wherever they're at, Fox Island in Michigan. And I'm going to go screw off and help these guys out and make campsites and camp and do some stuff. And So I'm really looking forward to staying involved and getting more involved. And we really look for like-minded individuals who want to help us out, help aviation out, keep some of these small strips going. You know, when I listened to Brian's pitch of Elkhorn Ranch, I mean, I love it out there. You know, just like a lot of you guys, I go hunting out, you know, west of Bismarck, west of Dickinson, you know, upland bird hunting, and I couldn't think of a neater place to land, you know, other than maybe the Missouri Breaks, which we do some stuff out there as well. But, you know, to land at the Elkhorn Ranch with your dog and your tent and spend a long weekend out there, or maybe during the middle of the week when nobody's out there hunting, I mean, how nice would that be? And so Brian's been working on it, you know, a lot, and you know, hopefully Jeff and I will have the opportunity to, you know, to support him when we meet with the ranger and start that process. We are talking in Minnesota of another airport. It's called Cox Coyer. I don't know if you have a picture of that, Brian, or anything, but Cox Coyer is this is a strip southwest of Baudette, Minnesota, up by Lake of the Woods. And it's a strip that's run by the DNR. It's not open to anybody. They actually, it's in a huge wildlife management area, and it's a lot of hunting, a lot of bird watching, things of that nature. And it would be great. It's great for grouse and woodcock hunting, but they don't let you fly into it. And so we're working with them to try to, you know, kickstart that and have access to that. The picture that you see here is actually, when you talk about Recreational Aviation Foundation, it's not all about airstrips. This is actually at Iceport. Iceport was actually just this last weekend. This happened to be 2 years ago at Iceport. But Iceport is over at Mille Lacs Lake, and they there's a restaurant right across the street. They spend weeks prepping an ice runway. And last weekend, I was actually out in Bismarck at a hockey tournament, state hockey peewee tournament. So I wasn't able to make it. But last weekend, just this past weekend, they had 170 airplanes fly in and park on the ice. And it's all, and they have tents set up, you know, and visitation, Tannis heaters, and, you know, all these different outfits and supporters. And it was, you know, it's just a blast. So for something to do in the winter. And another one that they have is up at Red Lake, and that's JR's. It's a resort up in Red Lake, and they have hot roast beef sandwiches and Yetis up there, Tannis heaters up there. Reef is up there. I mean, it's just amazing. And all these airplanes fly in, land on the ice. As you can see, a lot of them don't have skis. I happen to have 3200s on the 185, but you know, I don't have my skis down. They clean that ice off so you can land right there. And it's just a hoot. So, you know, when you think of recreational aviation, and I know most of you guys, you know, whether you're crop spraying or whether you're in 135 operations or Port 91 instructors or maintenance guys, you know, there's a recreational side of this, and we need to do more of it. We need to get together a little bit more often and have a little bit of fun, because if we don't, and we don't collaborate with these organizations, this stuff is going to go away. And hey, Rick, then Rick, what do we do?
Rick, you need to, if you would tell me about some benefits to this, sorry to go back to the Isle Airport, but some benefits about this if you're an RAF member.
Oh yeah. So before, this is a private, you know, it's considered a private airport. It's city owned, but it's still private. So what's happened now is because we got involved and we were able to assist the private entity who had to kind of facilitate the maintenance and all of that stuff, they've basically opened it up now. If you're an RAF member, you can come in here and have access not only to the airport, but right across the street is a bunch of resorts. But you can land here, you can camp. You know, there's, you can see there's a right behind the steerman, there's a porta potty for a restroom. So it's just a neat grass strip that if you want to get away for an afternoon or a weekend with your kid, you can go in, land here, pitch a tent, walk across the street to one of the resorts, rent a boat, rent a cabin if you choose to. And same thing with Bowstring. It's not a 200 yard walk and you're at the lake. And when I take my kid there, you know what he remembers? He remembers walking down to the resort and getting ice cream. And so every time we go to Bowstring, we walk down to the resort and get the ice cream cone. Same thing here at Isle Airport, just across the street. There's resorts that you can go to, and it's just a beautiful, beautiful spot. And because we pitched in and got involved, now we have access and we have an open invitation if you're an RAF member to come here and use the facilities and camp and do your thing. So those are the relationships that we're building, and we do it as Brian showed you the organizational chart. It's about the members first, and then the members build the organization. And I'll tell you what, the more you get to know the members, that's what's really, really fun, because you guys know, I mean, you get a bunch of pilots together, whether it's at a campfire or whether it's in a bar, it's usually pretty fun. I'll tell you, at the Bowstring work party, my son was there and we helped with these campsites. And at night we got together and guys brought a bunch of beer and we yucked it up. And my 12-year-old now, and I mean, I think he's in one of these pictures, but he laughed so hard. We walked back to the tent that night and he said, Papa, I laughed so hard I peed my pants. At the jokes and the guys, what the guys were talking about, the stories. And I'll tell you what, if you look at the end number on that airplane, 926 Hotel Mike, that's September 26. And that's my son's initials. So that's his airplane. And he's going to inherit this airplane. And I told him when he's done with it, he gives it to the RAF. And that airplane will be someone else's airplane then. And, the idea that the experiences that this young kid's going to have flying around and meeting characters like that are on this call, I couldn't ask for a better group of guys to get involved with. So that's my pitch and I'm sticking to it. Well, anything else, Brian?
Well, that was great.
Yeah.
That was a good way to put it.
Well, it's a good organization. And if you guys get solicited, we're asking you to pitch in a little bit, because these airstrips don't get put together and saved by just luck. I mean, it's guys working their tail off administratively to make the connections, but then physically to put it all together. And as you guys know, it just doesn't happen for free, And so when the RAF makes a pitch, don't hesitate to take out your wallet and give us $50 or whatever, because it makes a big difference. It saves airstrips and it changes people's lives. And I can attest to that.
Very good, Rick. And we're just, so they didn't want us to go quite a full hour. So we're just about out of time here. And the only chat I see is someone who, and that was right away, who really likes the idea of the area of the Elkhorn Ranchlands airstrip. But I'd be amiss if I didn't mention our neighbors to the west a little more. Montana, that's where Ryan Field was. We talked about that a little bit. Rick mentioned some of the Missouri Breaks airstrip. This is Bullwacker up in there. There's about 5 airstrips. That's like between Lewiston and Havre up in that area. And then there's Russian Flats, which is a brand new airstrip 5 years ago, in that it didn't exist before. And that's, you're not quite out in the mountains yet. This is southwest of Great Falls yet. So there's airstrips you can get to, even if you're not a quote mountain pilot. And then of course you go farther into Montana, into Idaho, then you've got all those very good trade name airstrips that you think about more when you think about backcountry airstrips. One thing I did want to get to before we run out of time is Now, you probably didn't remember all every airstrip we talked about, but I would point you to the RAF's airfield guide. It's going to ask you to register, but you don't have to be a member, although we'd like you to. And that's got information on these airstrips that we talked about and many, many more. We've got three in North Dakota, the three we talked about today, the Peace Gardens and Riverdale and Park River. And we plan on putting more in there. And, you know, a lot of it's the same as information as you got in AirNav and stuff, but we then take that information and add, we concentrate on the recreational activities are there. You can do a search, and then I don't have another screen I could bring up, but you have several different things you can look at. Check that out. You don't have to be a member to look that over. And so with that, we're going to conclude so that people can take a break and then get to their next session. But I would really like to thank all of you for attending. The Rick mentioned the RAF.org. If you want to donate, go to www.theraf.org. If you'd like to talk to me or send me a message, brao@theraf.org. Rick, his real name is Richard Mercil at yahoo.com. And so with that, we're going to conclude our presentation. We sure thank you for attending. And as good as this works, we hope to get together with you all next year again.
Yep. Rick? Thanks, guys.
Thank you.